Hi guys, I'm Tyler with Fish Tank Consulting, and today we're going to be going over how to configure your first XM Cloud starter kit. Okay, so there's going to be six main sections of this video. Part one is going to be the environment installation prerequisites, where we go over the stuff that you'll need to bring up your environment. Step two is going to be downloading the XM starter kit from the GitHub repo. Step three is going to be the general initialization. Step four is going to be some common initialization problems and how we can kind of work around those. Step five is going to be running up the solution. And then step six is going to be creating a simple site just to get you started. Okay, so this is the list of prerequisites for what we need to get Sitecore up and running on our Windows machine. The main thing on here that you need to ensure that you match exactly is to ensure you have Windows 11 Pro. Windows 11 Pro comes with the Hyper-V feature. Without it, we're not going to be able to get Sitecore up and running on our local systems. Other than that, we just need Git for Windows and NVM for Windows, PowerShell 5.1, Windows Subsystems for Linux, so WSL2, the Ubuntu Linux kernel, Docker Desktop, we're using 4.18, the SDK for .NET 6, and then .NET Framework 4.8, and then obviously a Sitecore license file. Now, the version numbers here is just what we have found work best for us, but if your company is recommending using a different version of any of these items, then ensure you use that instead. So there'll be links for all these items in the description of the video. You can just go in there and click and install each one. There should be a small description as well, explain kind of how to install it for some of the slightly more complicated ones. I'm not going to go over them in the video because I don't want the video to take 9 years. Once you've ensured you've passed all the prerequisites, the next step is to come to the Sitecore Labs XM Cloud Foundation Head GitHub page and download the starter kit. This is super simple and easy to do. You just come to this link here, Sitecore Labs XM Cloud Foundation Head. The link will be in the description. Click the green code button and then click download zip. Once you've downloaded a zip version of the repo, you can just come to the downloads folder and you want to extract this file. A small tip when extracting files that might be helpful down the road is to try and keep the extracted file location as high up in your nested file tree as possible, so directly on your C drive. This just helps prevent nested file issues later down the road if you have a very expansive and intense repo. So an example of that would just be to put the extraction file directly here on the C drive like this. But for the sake of this video, I'm going to leave it directly in the downloads folder because it's not too important. Once extracted, the next step is to ensure that all the files are set to not read-only. By default, some of the files are initiated as read-only, so you can right-click on the new extracted folder and then click on properties. Once here, you just want to uncheck this read-only file option. Upon clicking apply, you want to ensure you select apply changes to this folder and subfolders and files, and then click OK. Before we continue configuring our XM Cloud starter kit, there's a few pre-initialization things that you want to do. Step one is to make sure that IIS is not running if you have it installed or running on your system. You can use that using the simple command on screen right now. The next thing is to also ensure that if you have Solr running locally, that also must be stopped. You can just review the services and stop it there, or you can just use another command. The key here is you want to ensure that nothing is running on port 8984. So the next step on actually configuring the starter kit to get going, we want to run PowerShell in Administrator. So you can just open a casual Administrator PowerShell window. And then what we want to do is run the init command. So we'll need a CD into the directory of our XM Cloud starter kit. So we can just copy the location here and CD directly into it. And then we want to run the following command. So this command will be in the description as well as on screen now. The key important part here is we want to input the location of our license file. Now, you may need to ask a senior dev on your team where your team likes to locate their license file, so it's the same across the board. But for my company, we put it in a slash license folder directly in the root C drive root directory. Upon doing this and hitting enter, the next thing you'll see is the Sitecore configuration pages here. So you can see preparing your Sitecore containers, adding Sitecore PowerShell gallery. So right now it's installing all of the Sitecore required files, certificates and tools. Once it's finished installing, it didn't take long. We can notice right here to avoid HTTPS errors, we need to set the certs environment variable as follows. So if you haven't done this already, you want to ensure that you do set this. So you can just copy the code in directly from there and then hit enter. And then this will successfully specify the value is saved. So quick and easy. The key thing to note here is that we only need to run this certs command if it's the first time we're setting up a Sitecore solution on our computer. If it doesn't work in the PowerShell window, just simply open up another command prompt window instead of PowerShell and try running it there. Next, we want to fix some of Sitecore's problematic initialization outputs. So basically, inside the initialization script we just ran, Sitecore is modifying some environment variable values in the repository's main env file. unfortunately add some dollar sign characters to some of the values, and these characters may cause problems when running Docker containers down the road later. So we should just manually remove them now. So it's a super simple process. We just want to open up the env file inside the main starter kit folder here in just a random text editor. So it's just this env file right here. I'm just going to open it in Notepad++. And all we need to do now is just replace any instances of the dollar sign character with a random letter or number of your choice. It doesn't really matter. But the key is to keep the strings the same length and to not have the dollar sign characters in them. So in here, we're just going to control F, drag this across, and do a control replace here. So inside here, we're just going to look for the dollar sign. So, and then we're just going to simply replace it with an S. And then I'm just going to hit replace all. And you can see it replaced three occurrences. After this, we just need to ensure that we've resaved the env file, and now we're good to go. So the next step now is just to run the up command that comes with the repository. So if I open up the file here, we can scroll down, and you can see there's these .ps1 PowerScript files. We just want to run this up.ps1 file. So inside our PowerShell window here, we just want to simply do a .slash up.ps1. Simple, then hit enter, and this will run the files. As you can see here, it's checking my license. Our license for our company is valid for the rest of the year. And then now it's pulling down all the rest of the files that are needed and pushing up the repo. So a lot of situations where this initialization might fail. And if that's the case, it's not a big deal. Just reach out to a senior dev on your team and they should be able to help you. But the first thing you can try is a Docker system prune. So just take the instance down by doing a ./down and then do a Docker system prune and then try pulling it up again. If you're still receiving errors and the Docker system prune didn't work after bringing your solution down, you can bring your solution down again and you can use this clean PS1 file. So if you go inside the Docker folder here, there's this clean PowerShell script. When you run this, it'll essentially recreate everything in the solution. So this is how you'll start from scratch. And you can try this again and then try another up to see if it works. And then again, if it keeps failing, just contact a senior dev on your team. So now we're just starting up each Docker container. This can take a while, so don't be worried if this takes some time. I'm obviously going to cut here to keep the video at a reasonable speed, but if there's going to be an error, it's most likely going to be here. One thing of note, if you're stuck on this specific step for a long period of time, is at the top of the PowerShell window here, if it says Select Administrator, it means you've accidentally clicked on the PowerShell window. So if you just click in again, like see, if I click in here, it says Select Administrator, this actually stops the PowerShell window from showing more details as it's progressing. So most likely it's progressed to the next step, or maybe even errored out and it's just not telling you. So to fix that, you just need to hit a key on your keyboard to remove yourself from the Select Administrator mode so you can stay up to date with the progress. So as you can see, all the containers have been brought up and successfully and everything's going well. And it's now prompted me to log into Sitecore. It's done it on my secondary monitor here. So if I pull this up here, you can just see device confirmation, Sitecore, simply clicking confirm. And it's going to ask me to log in to Sitecore. If you don't have an account yet, you can simply sign up and just use your company's email address, and then they can add you to the organization at a later date. But obviously for now, I'm just going to log into my account that already exists and then select my organization. Once you've done that, you should use congratulations, you're all set page. And you can open back up your PowerShell window and it'll start to run the popularization Solimage schema. So it's going to index all the different databases. There's three different databases in Sitecore, so it'll index each one. This may take a little bit of time, so don't be alarmed if it runs pretty slowly. So as you can see, it's pulled it up correctly. And then now it's trying to, once again, ask me for my organization. So I'm just going to click on my organization here. And it will load me directly into Sitecore. So after the first initial successful spin up of your container environment, that up.ps1 script is actually not needed anymore. The up.ps1 script is only needed the first time you set up a new Sitecore container project, and if you run that clean ps1 file, or if you want to update your local Docker images with the latest XM Cloud based Docker images. All these subsequent spin ups of the container environment can actually be done using the Docker compose up-d command on screen. Another important thing to note here is before turning off or restarting your computer, you should run a .down to bring down all your Docker containers. Some developers on our team have had issues where their Docker breaks or they have massive cache files, so they're running out of space on their C drive and these files were unable to be deleted because they were locked up in Docker. So XM Cloud is actually up and running on your system. All we need to do now is just connect the content editor directly to our new site that was created in the starter kit. So to do this, we need to open the content editor, but we're actually going to do this through the desktop. The desktop has a few extra features here that you can open up, mainly these along the side. So it's just better to kind of get in the habit of using the desktop now instead of switching later when you realize you need those features. You can just click on the little icon here, then click content editor to open it up. And then once here, we're going to add a new site. One thing to note is that Sitecore can be pretty slow at times, especially if you're running on an older system. When you click on something, just wait. Eventually it will load. You just have to give Sitecore time to keep up with your system. So once here on this content tree item, you want to right click, insert. We're going to insert a new headless site collection. This collection we're just going to name as sites. And we want to ensure that all the modules here are checked off. And then click OK. So we have our site section here now. The next step is we want to insert a new headless site directly into this site. So we just want to right click, insert, and then select headless site. Now here it wants the site name. Now it's important that we name the site name the same thing as the starter kit created. So if you open up your starter kit here, the extracted folder, you want to open up this source file and you should see a starter kit name. So right here, SXA starter kit. So I'm actually going to use this name as our site name. To be more specific, it actually has to be the same name and casing as the item inside the package JSON. So if I'm to open up the package JSON here, if I just open this in Notepad, it's going to be this specific app name here. So if you want to change the name, this is where it matters. So it's going to copy this SXA app name on line 7, and we're going to paste it in here as the new site name. Then we want to go over to the modules tab. In here, we just want to keep the default selections and make sure that we check the basic site module here at the top, which is default unchecked. Once we do that, we can just click OK. Awesome. Now our site's been created. We can just click close. And then we can see here we have our site module. And inside here, we have all these other in-depth content modules. Just as a general overview to Sitecore, these items here are kind of structured like so. So home, this is where all your content items are. This is where you'll store your pages. Media is pretty self-explanatory. These are all your media files. Data, these are called data sources. These are where your items, when you create new reusable components, this is where the data for those items will sit. So each individual page actually also has a data folder. These operate the same. Generally, the idea is to store data items per page in the data section here, and then globally accessible data items inside this data folder. Presentation here, this is how we configure renderings. So available renderings, this is how we store new renderings that we create. Page designs and partial designs can be linked directly to pages. So partials can go inside a page design, and then those page designs can be linked directly to the about page. Placeholders can generally be used to create containers. Some examples of this might be restricting which items you want displayed in each container. So if the user places down a grid container, inside that container we can restrict it to only use specific components that we've created. And then styles, these are like adding individual classes and styles to your components. And settings are just the more high level advanced settings for the site. The timestamps are on screen if you want to go back and rewatch a certain section in case you got stuck. Otherwise, thanks for watching and I hope you found this video helpful.